Welcome to This Week in Missouri Politics. Happy Easter to all of you watching. And we are joined by Congresswoman Ann Wagner. Congresswoman, happy Easter.
And happy Easter to you and all of your viewers.
It's very nice to have you on this week. A lot of things in the news. First of all, you announced your fundraising totals, almost $3 million. Seems like that's a hefty total, or maybe you have some, maybe you have another race in mind.
Well, I will tell you, I'm just pleased to have a lot of support, especially here in Missouri, across the whole state of Missouri, and the nation. This is an important election cycle in 2018, and it's going to take resources to get our message out. So I'm just gratified and humbled by the support that we're receiving.
People have gotten used to seeing these big fundraising numbers, but raising money for a federal race is very different than a state race in past cycles. I mean, you have to raise that money a little bit at a time from a lot of different groups and people.
You sure do, and it's a grassroots effort. The most that you can take from any individual is $2,700, which is a lot, but you raise it $50, $100, $10, whatever it takes at a time. So I'm pleased to get out and do that. It's a way of, I think, showing grassroots support through your fundraising numbers. So I'm pleased with the numbers we've brought in, and I'm just getting started, Scott.
So you're somebody that's always been known to speak your mind. President Donald Trump, the one thing about him is he always been known to speak his mind. You guys have had pretty frank conversations, but what's it like working with him on legislation?
It's been amazing. I'll tell you what, I've been in the White House now 5 or 6 times since the president's been in, not even 100 days yet, working with him on his agenda, whether it's the regulatory reform, the executive orders, that I've been able to stand right next to him as he's signed, and he's given me the opportunity to explain those to the American people. Healthcare. Been in the Oval Office with him as we're whipping votes, as we're working to try and get to a solution. And I am absolutely committed to repealing and replacing Obamacare, and I believe we're going to get there as a House,
You're
as a
Congress. You're with the President on that vote, correct?
You bet.
So I just see him as a guy that's thick-skinned, as a guy that wants to see things get done. I would think you two in a room together would have some commonalities there.
We really do. Neither one of us want any grass to grow underneath our feet. We are doers. We want to get things done, and I respect that very much. I've seen the strength and the leadership that he brings to the table, and a negotiation skill that really puts him in the center of things. He wants to be an agent for change. He is a disruptor. I love that. And we've really gotten along well with he and his entire team.
We talked about some new things that you're doing now, but you've been in this fight for a very long time. Pro-life causes, Republican causes, people serving legislative districts today that still look like the ones you helped draw a long time ago. Why do you do this cycle after cycle?
You know, it's a calling. It's not a job. It's truly about serving a cause greater than oneself. People don't know the Ann Wagner story. And maybe it's because I haven't told it enough, but you know, I'm a South County girl who grew up off Gravoy Road in a little house with a carport, a mom who was a school teacher, a dad who was a traveling salesman. My parents worked hard and leveraged everything at one point to pursue their American dream and open up a little carpet store out in West St. Louis County. We moved out there when I was young, and I worked in that store, Scott, since I was 12 years old, with my dad teaching me the value of hard work and the value of a dollar, how to communicate with people, get the government off his back and out of his way. Those were his mantras. He wanted his oldest daughter to go to college. He'd never gone to college. My father had not. And he wanted me to go to Mizzou to business school. I wanted to be a Broadway singer. And we split the difference. I went to Mizzou on a, believe it or not, a vocal music performance scholarship.
No kidding.
Don't tell anybody. Got that business degree. Had the privilege of working across the state at Hallmark Cards in Kansas City, mm-hmm. Ralston Purina back here in St. Louis. Before it was John Ashcroft that kind of touched my husband and my heart and brought us into conservative politics and the Republican cause. It was a way for me to express my values and the value set that I'd grown up with. And I've worked at the grassroots level as a volunteer, 9 years as a township committee woman. Certainly as a chairman of the party, volunteer again, digging in, building these majorities, really using the party as a way to take the causes, whether it's Second Amendment, whether it's pro-life issues, pro-growth and jobs and economy, getting the government out of your way, returning your freedoms, limited government. Those things were important to me, instilled in me, and was able to then rise in the party ranks, get more done. I've served and had the privilege at the national level, internationally, put my own name on the yard sign to run for Congress, raised three kids. Well, not that you're ever done raising them, but married for 30 years to a wonderful, supportive man. It's been a great journey and a
that's
wonderful
opportunity. That's something people don't talk enough about, I think, is the party, the Republican Party that's been built by people that have had to work very hard for a long time when there wasn't Republicans everywhere in the state. I guess the people like it pretty well because it's pretty dominant today.
It is, and to be a part of growing and making that majority. When I started out as party chairman, and the only woman to ever do so, as a mom with three kids running around, and an activist, just a grassroots gal, we didn't have the majorities that we have, and we were able to do that during my tenure with a whole lot of help. I worked across this state with so many to make sure that we're in the place where we are now, and to see this last election cycle with a clean sweep, it's time to govern, get things done, but this is a dream come true to me.
Let me ask you about a letter that was in the news recently. Another person that's been working in it even before you, former Senator Danforth, seemed to be the headliner on a letter encouraging Josh Hawley to run for Senate. He's the Attorney General, obviously would be a good candidate. You've been mentioned as a potential candidate for Senate. What was your reaction when you read that letter?
Well, I have the great utmost respect for Senator Danforth and admiration, and I'm grateful for the much of the path that he's blazed and the trail that he's blazed for all of us. And I think Josh Hawley is a terrific Attorney General who has a bright, bright future. We haven't had this Attorney General seat, Scott, since 1992. Yep. There are so many important things that need to be done. I supported Josh in the primary and was a big fan of his. As I said, I can't say enough good things about Josh and the future that he has, along with our entire ticket. We have a deep bench of our statewide candidates, mm-hmm. our leadership in the House and the Senate, many in Congress that I serve with. I love all their names being mentioned for the U.S. Senate. As I said, we've got a deep bench, and I think all of them would be willing to and able to step up to that opportunity.
Let's talk about an interesting thing. Whoever does have that opportunity running is Claire McCaskill. It was my take that Claire McCaskill might have voted for a nominee like a Neil Gorsuch, except that worried about her left and her primary. What did you think? Did you think she really thinks Neil Gorsuch is not a qualified nominee from a Republican president?
I don't know what she's thinking, but I know this. Claire McCaskill is utterly out of step with Missouri values. Neil Gorsuch was a wonderful, qualified jurist to take the spot of Antonin Scalia. And the fact that she not only voted against Judge Gorsuch, but also wouldn't even filibustered and wouldn't even bring him to a vote on the floor is so out of touch with Missouri. And I'll tell you, Scott, it's why I am personally taking a very, very renewed and close look at this U.S. Senate race in 2018. I think her vote was a slap in the face to Missourians, many of whom supported President Trump mm-hmm. because of the bench and because of what he was going to be able to do on things like the Supreme Court and beyond. So we need a senator that represents Missouri values, that speaks for my neighbors, the people that I'm at church with this morning, the people that live across our entire wonderful state, the farming community, the business community, the small business communities, the moms, the dads, the families that are just trying to build something and have a better way of life. And she's out of touch, whether it's Obamacare, her liberal agenda, the 2 years that she spent stumping for Hillary Clinton. This isn't the kind of representation that I want in the U.S. Senate, and I think it needs to be challenged.
And that'll be the fall campaign, you think?
You bet.
Interesting. Let me just ask you, will you be a part of that fall campaign? Are you planning to run for U.S. Senate?
Well, I will certainly be a part of the fall campaign. I've got a job to do right now in the U.S. House. The people of the 2nd District have sent me there. As I said, it's a calling, a privilege to serve every day. In the words of my father, who said, be productive, give back to your community, stay grounded in who you are. And we are taking a very, very serious look at the U.S. Senate. I'll come back and potentially announce it right here with you, Scott, when the time is right.
We may very well hold you to that. First of all, thank you for joining us. Appreciate you on this Easter Sunday. I appreciate it. And happy Easter to you and your family.
Thank you. I can't wait. We're going to get back out to our cabin in Warren County, do some fishing, some barbecuing, and celebrate the resurrection of our Lord.
We get to do a double because we have Gussie's first birthdays on Easter Sunday. So we're going to do Easter egg hunt, birthday, ESPN took the Cardinal game, which I'm not happy about. But anyway, we look forward to talking about the Senate race and everything else on This Week in Missouri Politics.
Thanks, Scott. Thanks for the opportunity.
We'll be right back. Chris Kelly makes his panel debut on This Week. Stay tuned.
My name is Eric Phillippe. I'm a veteran, a carpenter, and a father. When Eric Greitens said he was going to change politics as usual, folks like me didn't think the first thing he'd do as governor was take dead aim at our jobs and our families' livelihoods by working to repeal prevailing wage. Call Governor Greitens. Tell him to protect prevailing wage and to protect my family, not destroy it.
All across Missouri, our new car and truck dealers are building strong local economies. When you buy a car or truck in Missouri, you're helping to support over 20,000 Missouri families who rely on the auto industry for good-paying local jobs. You're also helping fund our communities, schools, first responders, and our roads, because dealers generate millions of dollars in tax revenue. Missouri's automobile dealers have been the foundation of our communities for generations and for generations to come. The Missouri Automobile Dealers Association, the heart of Missouri.
Nobody likes power outages, including us. That's why Ameren Missouri is investing in new equipment and smarter technology to reduce outages and keep pace with future needs. And it's working. We're in the top 25% in the nation for reliability. And on average, our rates are 18% lower than other Midwestern states. Making sure the power's there when you need it. That's energy at work. Ameren, Missouri.
Welcome back to our Easter Sunday Opinion Maker panel. We are joined by St. Louis legend, St. Louis Magazine founder Ray Hartman. Thank you very much, sir.
Thanks for having me.
Chris Kelly, the one we probably ask you to be on as much as anybody in the history of this show. We're glad you finally made it over.
I'm delighted to be here.
Rising star in the Republican Party. Very glad to have Travis Fitzwater back on the show here.
Glad to be here.
Brian Spencer here in the St. Louis area. Glad to have you, sir.
Happy Easter to you.
Happy Easter to you. And interesting interview by Congresswoman Wagner. I think most folks assume she was running. I think now if you don't think Josh Hawley's running, you should probably pay attention more. Interesting thing, I was particularly interested to hear her reaction to that letter.
Yeah, it's a fascinating development this week. I don't know that it's, for some of us Republicans, it's out in left field like some people may think it is, but I really like Ann. She knows people well around the state. I think what's really exciting at this Austin Stukins, who we hired to be the GOP executive director, is an impressive guy. Just had lunch with him the other day. They are going to focus, the party's going to focus on this race. This is going to be the thing we go after. I think it's a real opportunity for the Republicans to have another U.S. Senate seat in Missouri. And so I'm excited about the development there, whether it's Ann or whether it's another qualified candidate gets in.
So we had Peter Hirsch and you had Peter Kinder. I thought was interesting. Some folks had thought he might run himself. All kind of throwing behind Hawley. There's a large amount of support behind Ann Wagner. That shapes up to be a pretty big primary.
What I really like is that the Republican Party has a very deep bench, and we have a lot of qualified people that could do that seat very well.
There are many times Republicans have went to run for statewide offices, and that bench did not exist to the extent it does now.
It does now.
Chris Kelly, you've watched a lot of people run for office. I was interested to see how she handled the question about that letter. It's interesting to me to see folks that I think some people, if they didn't pay close attention, would have thought some of those St. Louis folks would have backed the St. Louis, a congresswoman from the St. Louis area, and said they're backing Josh Hawley. But now she has a bunch of heavy hitters on her side as well.
They all got a big problem trying to beat Claire, because Claire knows Missouri and knows rural Missouri and is very well liked by the voters for good reason. She's been a competent public official for 30 years in this state, and people know that.
Will this be a referendum on Donald Trump, and is that good for either one of them?
We don't know. Let's assume Trump does something right. Mm-hmm. That can change the dynamics significantly. And right now, the Kansas race, I think, you know, Democrats are crowing about it, but you know what? Republicans won, and winning is important.
But they are fired up. I mean, there's a Democrat, I think, of a union Democrat. I think of Democrats like yourself that get things done and provide things to people. There's a whole other wing now that's probably just socialist Democrats, and they're very excited.
Yeah, and we've got those, and the Republicans have got the lunatic
Absolutely.
Right. And, you know, you both have to worry about the fringes.
Ray Hartman, it's an interesting thing to me. You're seeing this deep bench now is going to run against each other in primaries. It's kind of what you see with Democrats. They'd win all the races, and then they'd fight over the net moving up. Interesting thing. Who do you think has the advantage going in?
Well, as I say, I agree. Happen to believe Claire McCaskill is a real good U.S. senator who's going to win.
She's going to be tough.
And even if it wasn't structurally a good year for her to run, which is no matter who's in office, the first... 18 is going to be a good Democratic year in all mm-hmm. likelihood, just like 14 was good for the Republicans and 10.
Sure.
Just the structure of it. I do think that we saw in this last election that traditional endorsements from supposedly powerful people don't mean a whole lot now. It was a little stunning to see Jack Danforth, you know, this early basically bail on Ann Wagner, and that was in terms of that letter. It was also stunning to see a guy who, whatever you think about him, and he ran commercials about about how you shouldn't be climbing ladders right away. He's been in office less than 3 months. I mean, yeah, decorum, this isn't a partisan statement, you would think somebody would be in office a little longer, his first statewide office, before he starts being, you know, moved on to the next one. And it seems awfully early to me to be having this, what appears to be a little civil war going on. And again, I understand you can view it as a deep bench or you can view it as a little civil war, but don't you think you ought to wait a little bit till he's had the chance to do something?
Brian Spitzer, that ad comes back to hurt him. I mean, right. I mean, that is something he's going to have to explain as he moves his campaign forward, right?
That is something he's going to have to explain, but you also have to look at that we have a president and we have a governor who jumped on the ladder at the top. So it's something that he can do.
What do you think? Can you really say Josh Hawley's done a lot as Attorney General yet? He probably doesn't know he's around the office.
He's done a lot as an attorney. He's barely
been in office, and it's so patently obvious that it's just about the next office.
Travis Israel, you have a knack for politics, there's no doubt. I think Josh Hawley's a top-tier candidate.
He is.
And the guy can raise money. He's a conservative's conservative. But that ad, he did run. He's clearly doing what he was saying is not the
sure,
most.
Sure, and I think going back to what Chris mentioned earlier, beyond just who wins in the primary, I think it's important that Republicans in Congress and D.C. get something done so that 18 isn't this wave election for Democrats. An infrastructure bill, a tax reform issue, reforming
Obamacare,
tax,
right.
Obamacare. I mean, you have to look at these things. You have to get something accomplished or 18 is going to be hard for Republicans.
Give me a prediction. Who is the Republican nominee for U.S. Senate?
I'm going to say Ann Wagner.
Who do you think?
I think the money's got to be on Ann right now.
I think you have to see, you have a David Wassinger, you have a David Steelman may enter that mix. What do you think?
Let's not forget Mike Keogh. Mike
Absolutely.
Keogh is one of the finest legislators in Jeff City, and he's a juggernaut. The other thing about Hawley to remember is he's different than Ashcroft, Danforth, Eagleton, Nixon, in that he has completely turned his office into a political machine. All of those guys were politicians with political agendas, but they didn't do what Hawley is doing. They all had professional legal shops, whereas Hawley has fired the vast majority of his competent lawyers and hired political hacks. Now he's forced to go outside to private law firms that supported him in the election to get his real legal help. That's going to be a problem.
I almost want to duck it only because of the Trump factor. We don't even know if Trump's going to be president. I mean, who knows? I mean, the Trump factor is so bizarre. And I don't mean in any direction.
It is a big issue. There's no
that
question.
It's almost about, if I had to say it tomorrow, I have a feeling it's going to be Hawley because he's got a safe seat and he's so ambitious. And again, it's so obvious. It isn't about governing. It's about the next office. I don't know. Maybe you only stay in the Senate a few couple months and go on to the next one, maybe running for president. I mean, really, it's like, it's just like he's passing through. You know, I mean, it's stunning to me, but and of course, the good news for Ann is that I almost never get a prediction right.
There you go.
I'll say Hawley.
We do have somebody that knows the state budget very well here. So the state budget comes through the House. They kept managed care. They even raised taxes on the circuit breaker. Now goes to the Senate, where Senator Schaaf has made it his priority to kill it. Looks like the Senate may go along with his version and take it out. What do you think happens at the end of the day?
I think for anybody in the Capitol building to underestimate Scott Fitzpatrick makes a huge mistake. He's young, but he's very smart, and he really has worked hard to learn the budget. And not only that, he has the absolute support of a very talented speaker in Mark Richardson. And so anybody who...
Freudian slip there. Todd Richardson, I think.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, I serve with Todd's father, too. But anybody who underestimates the House and the budget process this year is making a big mistake.
What do you think, Ray Harmon? It's an interesting thing to see the circuit breaker taken out. I
wonder
if
I wrote
stays.
About the circuit breaker, yeah. In St. Louis Magazine. I was a Republican speechwriter for Kit Bond before I think some of you were born, which is kind of sad. You might have been.
I'm sure Kelly was here, yeah.
But seriously, in the first term of Kit Bond, and I got there in '75, about the time stuff stopped getting accomplished somehow. I don't know how that was related.
Bad luck.
But I think Kit Bond's first term was possibly the best term any governor's ever had in the state of Missouri. And one of the things he was proudest of was tax relief for the elderly, the circuit breaker. And this issue of renters, you know, being excluded, like they somehow don't pay property tax, was not even discussed. It was a bipartisan spirit. Jim Conway, who went on to become mayor, proposed the bill. It was not an issue. The idea that you folks are gonna cut $500 a piece from 100,000 elderly disabled people is so beyond heartless. And the idea that they're renters, they're not paying property tax. Let me ask you this. Any of you pay sales tax on purchases?
That's an argument Republicans don't want to make.
Any of you pay sales tax on purchases in the state of Missouri? Can you show me your receipts to the Department of Revenue for those purchases? Guess what? I own a retail store. We collect your sales tax. We pay it. So I guess you don't pay sales tax in Missouri because you can't show me where you pay the Department of Revenue. People who pay rent are paying property taxes. I used to own a commercial shopping center. Even as bad a landlord as I was, you know, in terms of being stupid, you know, you collect rent for the and property tax is part of what you're collecting. So of course they pay property tax.
Representative Spitz, that's why he's a St. Louis legend. The circuit breaker's out. I know it was argued it wasn't a tax increase, but it was. Some tax were raised and revenue raised to balance the budget, right?
Well, I serve on the budget committee, mm-hmm. and you know there was cuts made across the board. And when we went through each department, it came down to do we provide a assisted living for the entire year, or do we give them a one check for $500 with the circuit breaker? So that dealt with the 21 versus 27
points. Reasons to raise taxes. No, I see your point. Representative, take us, you're at the crust of leadership in the House. Take us inside, if you don't mind, just 1 minute. So you've made a commitment to managed care. I remember when that bill was about to die, when the current speaker was the floor leader, I think it was his speech that saved it on the House floor. Do you think at the end of the day, is the House going to blink, or are they going to force managed care to happen?
I think it's going to be interesting to follow that over the next couple of weeks. I think, obviously, Senator Schaaf has been negotiating on that piece almost the whole session, mm-hmm. on a number of bills, holding up the Uber bill for this reason, holding up a number of House priorities in the Senate for managed care. It's going to be a fascinating conversation. We were talking about it before that, you know, does the Senate take it out and we bring it back in conference? Or does the Senate agree to portions of it?
Looks like they take it out, go to conference.
But healthcare is very expensive. And right now, healthcare is very siloed. So you pay for one silo that doesn't worry about the next silo. And so you have all these costs. You have to figure out a way to manage care in a way where you're worried about their pharmacy costs, their doctor's costs, and how they're all
the current
creating
system
a good healthcare.
Work, right? You can't sustain the current system. First
the current system is not sustainable.
So give me the prediction. People look to you. You're in those meetings. Do you blink?
I think managed care will be expanded to some extent in our budget.
Well, give me a prediction. Is managed care in this budget? Just like it was agreed to.
I don't think it survives. I mean, you have the two doctors in the House that are not for it. So I think they swayed us a lot on the different medical concerns.
Resident budget expert, is this state a managed care state by the end of June?
The opposition is just plain financial contributions. I think yes, because I think that the House is going to be ascendant in conference this year.
Very keen. He's been in those conferences. What do you think?
I'll defer to all you experts on that, the process. I will tell you from 40,000 feet, and we talk about running government like a business. I've had businesses for 40 years.
Not a,
Guess
not
what?
A business.
You're not allergic to revenue. And the fact that Missouri is the sixth lowest per capita state in raising money, and as a result of that, has the lowest paid state workforce in America, has one of the lowest supports of education, corrections, virtually everything that's important, had the audacity to walk away from billions on Medicaid expansion, which could have fixed a lot of this, for purely political reasons. I gotta tell you something. I think, with no respect, and I'm not talking about anybody individually, but collectively, our state government is morally bankrupt, period.
He's a St. Louis legend because he calls your money revenue. That's why he's the man.
It is revenue.
Let me ask you this. Prescription drug monitoring, does that happen? Is that going to be, will that be statewide?
It looks like, again, speaking of one of it, we're the only state in America, thanks to one doctor who, by the way, was nice enough to be honest and say that people dying of overdoses thins the gene pool. You know, I mean,
it was interesting to me to see, though, he sat down, Will Krause picks it up.
I mean, the Senate just last night perfected it or third read it. It's coming back to the House. It's going to get done. We're going to pass it in the House.
Are you going to pass that version?
I don't think you can send another version back to the Senate.
They stuck a couple poison pills in there, I think, hoping you'd kill it.
But I don't think you can send back a PDMP to the Senate and get it done.
Kill it.
You hope we kill it?
I mean, Virginia came out with a report that, you know, since they've had PDMP, that the overdoses on heroin have gone up. I think it was like 21%.
So you want to keep us the only state in the country that doesn't have a database for to help?
I don't want the government to have my name or anything.
Really?
Give me a real quick prediction, Representative Kelly. Okay. Does it go?
I think it will go. First of all, because all the morality and all the economic sense is that it goes. And I have had a career-long aversion to the House kowtowing to the Senate on important ethical legislation.
Quick prediction, with a minute left, who won the week?
Probably Josh Hawley, just because he got his name.
I think
name
that's in it.
He got his name.
What do you think? Who won the week?
In my opinion, Claire with her very fine town hall meetings.
Oh, those were good. Who won the week?
Kirk Matthews. You got Uber done this week.
Absolutely. Who won the week?
I'm going to say Wright City because of their Red, Right, and Blue festival for their canine dog.
See, Ray, that's why he's the Wright City legends because he never misses a shot in his district. I'm going to say who won the week is Governor Eric Greitens. Not a lot of folks outside the Capitol know this. He came to the softball tournament, played the whole time. Everybody came to him. I think he will see direct benefits in his legislative agenda because of the friends he made. It was a good week for the governor on a lot of different fronts. I want to thank you. Happy Easter and happy first birthday to Gussie Victor Fahn. We'll see you next week. This Week in Missouri Politics, brought to you by Spire and Sterling Bank.